We are in a series of messages called Jesus According to John. And I'm really excited about this one today because this one has a lot to say to the world that we live in today. And so I'm actually going to jump right into it. So fair enough, are you ready? And we're going to go into John chapter 4 today. Look on the screen or your technology, John chapter 4, verses 1 through 18. So I'm going to read a number of scriptures. Here we go. Now, when Jesus learned that the Pharisees had heard that Jesus was making and baptizing more disciples than John, although Jesus himself did not baptize, but only disciples, he left Judea and departed again for Galilee. And he had to pass through Samaria. So he came to a town of Samaria called Sychar, near the field that Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there. So Jesus, weary as he was from his journey, was sitting beside the well. It was about the sixth hour, that's noon. A woman from Samaria came to draw water. Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink." For his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "How is it that you, a Jew, ask for a drink from me, a woman of Samaria? For Jews have no dealings with Samaritans." Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that is saying to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." The woman said to him, "Sir, you have nothing to draw water with, and the well is deep. Where do you get that living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob? He gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did his sons and his livestock." Jesus said to her, "Everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks of the water that I will give him will never be thirsty again. The water that I will give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life." The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so that I will not be thirsty or have to come here to draw water." Jesus said to her, "Go call your husband and come here." The woman answered him, "I have no husband." And Jesus said to her, "You are right in saying, 'I have no husband,' for you have had five husbands, and the one you now have is not your husband. What you have said is true." All right, we're going to unpack this together today. And there's a lot of very, very pertinent, very up-to-date thoughts here that we want to make, especially trying to build the kind of church that we are going to build at South Point Community Church. We've been doing it, and we want to get better and better and better at this particular aspect of it, and this speaks to it deeply today. First thing that I want to draw your attention to, just quickly, because it's not the main body of the message today, but it's too important to leave. It says that Jesus leaves Galilee and to go to Judea, and left Judea to depart to go to Galilee. And now, what you have to understand here is there's a reason that he left. There's two things that happened here. He left for one reason, but the route that he took was a different one. All right? You have to be clear on this. The reason he left was one. The route that he took was different, or there was a different reason for that. The reason that he left, it says that the Pharisees learned that Jesus's group was growing faster than John's group was growing, John the Baptist. And it says, because when the Pharisees learned it, that there were more disciples, then we know from this that Jesus understood that the growth of his group was going to start to negatively affect John's group. And so he said, "Guys, it's time for us to go somewhere else and do ministry, because we don't want to be responsible to do any kind of hurt or muddy the stream or complicate things for John and what he's doing, because we love John's work." You understand that? So he basically says, "We're going to leave. Well, this kingdom value is something that we've got to get." This is an unbelievable lesson from Jesus to you and I of generosity, all right, and preserving the work of another. And it is so important. Jesus valued John's work and his testimony and what he was doing and his investment that he had made to build his group to express the kingdom of God and the coming of Jesus. Jesus valued that deeply and said, "I'm going to make sure that I take action to do things to protect that. So since mine is growing, I'm going to go to Judea. I'm sorry, to Galilee." So he leaves. It's so important. Laws out of this kind of thought right here. This is where laws in our culture come, the right to non-compete. And the whole laws, non-compete laws and clauses that are in contracts come out of things like this, that you don't build inside a man's house and then do something to hurt the house in which you lived and were blessed in. And so if something changes about you, you take steps to make sure that nothing you do, it will hurt or muddy the stream or complicate the work that's going on there. It's an act of generosity. It's preserving the work that exists. And it's a kingdom value that I think we have to see here that Jesus applied to his own ministry. So he said, you know, we're going to move to Galilee. Let's go. Now, the route that he took was another thing, because you didn't go through Samaria. It says in verse 4 that he says he had to pass through Samaria. Had to. Now, if you look at a map of that world in those days, there was Judea up here, Galilee down here. And then in the middle was this area. It was an area, like a county is what we would call it, called Samaria. It's still all the same country, but it's an area of Samaria where this group of people lived that, because they lived in Samaria, were called Samaritans. We're going to look at that in just a minute. Well, Jewish people didn't associate with these people. They didn't even walk through their country, and we'll look at that in just a minute. So if you were going to go from there to there, you always went one of these two ways. But you rarely went through the middle, right through Samaria. So the only reason that you would hardly ever that you would go through Samaria, you'd be very lazy, or two, which that one I don't even think needs to be considered. The other is time. It was a lot faster to go straight through the middle. So almost always when a Jewish person went through Samaria, it was because of a time limitation. And then they would go through. But we know in this case that there was no time limitation on Jesus. He wasn't in a hurry, and I'll show you that from the scriptures here in just a minute, but he wasn't in a hurry, so when he says, I have to go through, we know this, and I just want to get to the bottom line of it, is the Spirit of God was saying, go through. And all of that's going to get clear as we unpack these scriptures. So the Spirit of God goes, I want you to go to Galilee, but I want you to go through Samaria. So he gets a direct command, our opinion, my opinion, and many others, to go through Samaria. So the Spirit was leading him. All right, so they come upon a well in the city of Sychar. So they're walking through Samaria. They come to the city of Sychar, and there's a well there. It's a well that called Jacob's Well, that was given, that he gave to his son Joseph. And so we know that all from history and past, but that well is never mentioned in the Old Testament. This particular well is never mentioned. We just know about the allotment of land and how things went, and that was Joseph's allotment. So we call it Jacob's Well. Now, many people feel like this well right here is that well, okay? So this picture right here is often considered to be what is Jacob's Well. Now, obviously, it didn't have all that stuff built around it that there is today, and that well is still functioning. That well is still functioning, and so probably Jesus was propped up against that. You can't tell, but that's elevated right there, and it was probably sitting right there waiting for his disciples to get back, because he had sent them into town to get food whenever this lady walks up to him with a bucket to draw water out of that well. Interesting fact, it's just kind of fun. In the Greek, there are two words for well that are used. One is a well that you dug. You just dug down till you found water. And then the other is for finding a spring. In other words, it was a spring that came up out of the ground and you formed a well around it. And so in like one or two sentences, both are used. So you would think there's confusion, that the writer is going, well, was it a spring or was it a dug well? And we know this one because if you went to, well, that one that was up there a minute ago, if you went to the bottom of that one, what it was, they dug down thinking they were digging a well only to run into an underground spring. So it actually is a dug well with an underground spring. So the reason both words are used is because it was both. And that's why that one's still running freely today, because it's basically fed by an underground reservoir of water that flows. So I think that's fun. And wells, just real quick knowledge for all of you that are single, wells are good places to hang out. Because Jesus met the woman at the well, and obviously there's no romantic encounter there. But if you go in the Old Testament, Rebecca got her guy at a well. Rachel got her guy at a well. Moses found one of his brides at a well. All kinds of guys found women at wells to marry. And it's funny, almost all the well scenes, the guy shows off. Almost every scene you show at a well, he's out showing, I can move that rock. Hey, I can run off those shepherds. Hey, watch me, girl. I'm amazing. So I just want you to know, it's been that way since the beginning of time, ladies, that hey, he's going to get out and kind of, you know, unbutton two buttons on his shirt and show you who he is and try to impress you with something. And if he doesn't have anything under that shirt, then he's going to try to show you how much money he's got. Somehow, he's going to try to impress you. That's just what men do. And everybody who doesn't agree with that, just keep it to yourself. And it's just what a lot of men do that. I don't think every man does that, but a lot of guys do. And the girls go, oh. And so you see that in the Old Testament. So if you want to get married, you got to hang out at a well, but that's not a bar. A lot of people, when they'll hear the word bar, they'll go, you know, hey, it's the watering hole. You know what I mean? I'm going, no, you can't be hanging out at the club or the bar, and you're going to find the wrong one there, okay? Wrong guy, wrong girl, wrong people hanging out there to get married to. And I just want you to know that I proposed to Debbie at a well. That's why I brought this all up, actually, and just to tell you that, because it doesn't have a thing to do with the message, but I did. There's this little spring well thing in Rockford, Illinois, and I took her out there and said, hey, you want to marry me? And I mean, how could you say no? I should ask. I want to make it official, and I'm sure you want me to be with you for the rest of your life, but just so you can say I asked you, the romantic that I am. I did mess up on the ring thing. I got the ring, and she was sitting in the car with me, and we were taking a girl home, and I go, hey, by the way, I got the ring, and just showed it to her, and she goes, you are awful. You don't show me this in front of her, and what are you doing? So I got in trouble showing the ring. I did it wrong. That has nothing to do with anything right now, so. But for those of you guys who messed the whole romantic thing up, you're in the right church. You're in the right church. I'm your leader. Hallelujah. We got better as time went on, didn't we, guys? Okay, so it's about noon, and Jesus is hungry and he's tired, and he sits down to rest and sends his disciples into town to buy some food. While he's sitting there resting, obviously we just said this, this woman comes out with a bucket to get water from the well. Lots of stuff is written about her gang. That she came to the well at noon because no one went to the well at noon. You have to read in there, so we don't know for sure, but it wasn't the time when women went out to draw water. They normally did it in the morning when it was cooler because it was quite a job to get all that water out, and then they put it on their head and walk back with it, or if they had to carry two buckets, it was a pretty strenuous deal. So you didn't do it in the heat of the day. So a lot of people think because she wasn't real popular in town and didn't want to be seen. I don't know if that's true or not, but we do know some other things about her, absolutely. And we know now why he had to go through Samaria. He had to go through Samaria for this one moment. The Holy Spirit said, go through Samaria, and sending you to Sychar, and you're going to stop at a well. Folks, listen to me. You guys are living on a course when many times you're finding yourself in divine appointments. God puts you there, and you're going, we normally don't go through here. But God goes, no, we're going through here because he's setting you up to meet somebody to do something for his kingdom you would have never dreamed. Don't ever miss that. Don't ever miss that. So here he is, and he's having this conversation with this woman, and we're going to listen in on it, kind of. And in order to listen in on the conversation properly, there's three things you've got to understand about what is happening here. And so I'm going to say it in these three things: a Samaritan, a woman, and a lifestyle. Everybody got that? A Samaritan, a woman, and a lifestyle. All right? Let me tell you about Samaritans real quick. Samaria, I told you, is this like this area of land in between Judea and Galilee. And people lived in that district, and obviously if they lived in that district, they were called Samaritans because of that. But here's who they were. You read about, if you're doing Through the Bible with us in the Bible Project, if you're doing that, then you remember reading about a civil war that took place in the tribes of Israel. And two of the tribes stayed in what was called the southern part of the kingdom. That became Judah. Remember, there was a king of Judah and a king of Israel, and you're going, why is there two kings now of one people? And it's because they had a bit of a civil war, not a bit of one, a serious one. And 10 of the tribes went to the northern kingdom, all right? And so this 10 tribes later on was attacked by Assyria. So Assyria just comes in and just devastates the whole nation, basically, but just wipes out these 10 tribes in the north and takes all their people captive, and we read about that in the Old Testament, and you're reading about that whole story. Daniel and all these people were taken off, and anything of any substance, anybody who had any influence, anybody that was had any worth, was taken out of the land and taken and made captive in Assyria. Later on, because they wanted that land for financial purposes, that's the reason they conquered people. It was for financial gain. It was for power. They needed money to come out of it. They wanted the land to do well. So they sent Assyrian people back to the northern kingdom and to populate it and get it working again so that it would produce and be fruitful. As a result of that, the remaining Israelites in the north were still there, intermarried with them over time. And so now we have people that are in this part of the kingdom that are not truly Jewish in bloodline. They're now mixed. They're not the same ethnic variety as they once were. The Samaritans were a different ethnicity. All right, and so the result of that, and you see things in the Old Testament. Remember Ezra and Nehemiah, when you read through that, and the Samaritans and the Jewish people had nothing to do with each other. There's several things you need to understand. The Samaritans became a people that were part Assyrian, part Jewish. And so the Jewish part of them served Jehovah and the law, the Torah, all of it. And then in comes the Assyrians with all of their gods and idols and religions. And got all mixed up. So they started adopting a few of those gods' rules and a few of that god's ways and those forms of worship along with Jehovah, and it's called syncretism. It's whenever you take a bunch of religions and stick them all together to make one. Well, the people in the south were still purely Jehovah. And they said, no, you have to worship God this way. And the result later on, we'll talk about this next week, because I'm actually going to go into this lady's story again next week to talk about worship. Very, very important message for South Point Community Church. And they ended up about 400 BC building their own Jerusalem in Gerizim. They built their own place of worship. So, no, you worship here. And of course, the people in the south said, no, you worship in Jerusalem. Remember, gang, for those of you who read the story, remember when the lady goes, you say God worships in this mountain, we say in that mountain? Those are the two places they're talking about. And so Jesus, we're going to talk about the whole thing about worship and why it matters and why methods of worship matter and all of that next week and what's really going on in the concept of worship. But today, I want to just stay with this one thought, is that they worship differently. And you remember in Ezra and Nehemiah, Nehemiah came out and said, you guys have nothing to do with us. You can't help build this temple. You can't worship here. And so there was this great animosity between them. Eventually, the Samaritans only used the first five books of the Torah, what we call the Pentateuch. The rest of it, Psalms and all the prophets, they wouldn't even acknowledge them as part of God's word because it talked about Jerusalem being the center of worship. And so because of all of this, it was just a mess. And Jewish people would have nothing to do with a Samaritan. Nothing to do with a Samaritan. Is everybody with me? They would have nothing to do with them at all. There was great animosity. And so when we look at our world today and we look at all across the world, the ethnic divides, this story talks about it in brilliant fashion, just uncovers exactly what we need to be thinking, because these people despised one another because of their ethnicity. Big deal. Really big deal. And here Jesus is sitting at a well, and she walks up to him, a Samaritan. Quite a story. And she says to him, look on the screen again, how is it that you, a Jew, ask for a drink from me, a woman of Samaria? So you see what she's saying, right? You guys don't talk to us. You don't interact with us. What are you doing asking me for a drink? And there's something that you have to understand here. I always get worried about these kind of things because the Greek, the way it's written, doesn't have the right translation in English. actually saying that we don't have anything in common is the best way to go, because it's making the point that Jewish people and Samaritan people do not hang out together, don't talk to each other, don't, they have great hatred for one another. So it says it better than the actual version, because it takes too much explanation out of the original to say what we get to with this. It actually says this: how are you asking me for a drink? Because you know that Jewish people don't use the same cooking utensils as Samaritans. That's what it means. It says you don't use the same cooking utensils as we do. So, but we know what that really means, and you'd have to write a paragraph to explain it. So in the translation, they get it down to one sentence: we don't have anything in common, we don't hang out together. But it's important that we go back and look at this cooking utensil thing, because we know they have dealings. It says, in some versions it says, you have no dealings with the Samaritans. But we know they have dealings. Where were the disciples right then? They were in Sychar buying stuff. So we know that they were in buying things. We know that they had dealings when it was necessary. In other words, if there was nobody else to deal with a Samaritan. If there was no other way to get it done, you could do it with a Samaritan. Just try not to. But don't ever let the cup of a Samaritan touch your lips. Don't ever let a spoon that they use to eat touch your mouth. Don't ever use their plate. What's he saying? What's being said here whenever Jesus goes, give me a drink? What is happening right here? I mean, this is a big, big deal. You see what he's saying? He wasn't saying, no, I know, I'm not just going to have dealings with you. I can sit down and be intimate with you. I can share life with you. If we're going to try to fix things, folks, you got to get right. You got to get way past financial dealings. You got to get way past financial equivalence. And I think all of that is a important thing at every level in life. I think it's huge. But if you want to have in the church what God wants, when he says, I want to have one people made up of multiple ethnicities, you got to eat together. And everything that it means to share life at the most intimate levels. That's your cup, I'll drink out of your cup. You drink out of my cup, that's your spoon, I'll drink. I'll use your spoon, you use my spoon. And then you just sit and think about it for a minute and you'll know exactly what I'm talking about. There's a level of acceptance as we try to move forward in moving divides into taking those gaps and closing them. There's a move that we've made and I'm proud of it, but it needs to go a lot farther. It needs to go a lot farther. And especially in God's church, so that we are a people who have become one as we've come to love one another at the depth of our hearts in intimacy. All right, women, that's the second one, women. So I said that she was a woman, I said that there was an ethnic problem, and that she was a Samaritan, and now there's a woman. Women were marginalized in those days. Now I know you can't imagine that ever happening to a woman, or that it could relate to our day at all. I'm sure we don't think of any ethnic problems going on in our world. Anybody? And are we having any women problems in our world today? Anybody? And so the culture was patriarchal. I mean, big time patriarchal. I mean, men were everything. And if a woman wasn't attached to a man, it was a struggle for her. If you weren't attached to a man, you were considered less culturally. Less. You were just less. You were a little bit dehumanized. And are often treated abusively in the culture that Jesus came into. And so here he is sitting at the well, and a Samaritan woman walks up to him, and he goes, give me a drink. Now, I want to ask you something. Is he being patriarchal when he goes, hey, woman, I'm glad you showed up. I need some water. Get me a drink. You get that? You hear the tone? Get me a drink. And in that society, she would have went, I hate you, but okay. That's what I do. It's what women do. Any woman feel that? It's what women do. So I'll do that. Is that what happened there? I'll be back. Just remember, is that what God of the universe would do? And so we have the woman problem, and so he's working through that one, and then there's the lifestyle problem. I mean, we know, as we go on, we'll look at it again here in a minute, that she was living in a relationship that she was not in marriage. So she was living an immoral lifestyle, even by her own standards, because in the first five books of the Torah, the Pentateuch, it says that's wrong. So she knew before God, Jehovah, she was wrong. She knew she was living that. She'd had five husbands before, so probably you could read all kinds of things into it. I would assume this girl probably had some serious identity issues and was really struggling to get something filled inside of her that she was looking for a man to do. But we don't know that for sure, but just the numbers kind of tell you that. And that might be why Jesus offers her living water a little bit later. And but so here we have a woman who's immoral. She's a woman, and she's a Samaritan. We got a lifestyle problem, we got a gender problem, and we got a ethnic problem. And here it all happens, right here at the well. Jesus breaks through all barriers in one moment. He'd already broken through another one that we tend to forget, but these stories are connected. Everybody who talks about the book of John says these are connected. Remember last week, Aaron talked about Nicodemus. Nicodemus was influential. He was a major leader in the religious elite, a very busy guy. All the stuff that Aaron was talking about how he's real busy and maybe that's why he came to meet Jesus at night and all of those things. So he's this guy, everybody knows him. He's the up and coming of the, he's on the right side of town. Over in the other end is a woman at the well, immoral, five husbands, living with a guy, trying to figure out how to make it in the world, probably didn't have a lot going on, immoral lifestyle. So here's one end of the spectrum, here's the other, and Jesus is going, I came to reach all of them. That is what Jesus is saying. He said, I've come to reach all of them. I don't have a higher disdain for this one that I have for this one. I don't have a higher disdain for this one that I do for this one. I've come to reach them all because they all need me. He takes a different approach with Nicodemus than he does the woman at the well, and I don't have time for that today, but there's a very different approach. But just know this, he brought truth to this one, grace to this one. He brought a different approach, but don't have time to go there today, and I don't even know why I mentioned it because I don't have time to go there today, so let's move on. And so we have Nicodemus, now the woman at the well. There's actually four people in those three chapters, two and a half chapters there, all of them different perspectives and places in life, so that you would know that the God of the prologue is out to reach all mankind. All right. Now, what are we supposed to walk away with this and think? What is important to us today? That's fine, Russ. We know more things than we used to know. Well, if you have the gospel, if you have the good news, if you have Jesus in you, if you are now the one who bears the message of the kingdom of God, if you are the one who has the message that Jesus had that day at the well, how are you supposed to live your life with Nicodemus or the woman at the well or anybody in between? You have got to be able to overcome all cultural barriers, all of them. You've got to be able to figure out a way through all the stuff that's inside of you that establishes biases and prejudice so that people can hear the message of the kingdom of God, who Jesus is on this earth. You cannot allow those cultural mindsets, the view through which people see the world is not the right one. You cannot read your Bible through the lens of the world that you have known and learned, that you've known and learned. You have to read your world through the lens of the Bible. And we've got to help the world get there. We can't have cultural Christians. We've got to have kingdom Christians. I want to read this paragraph, and I'm going to show you how this matters. Our world is polarized and divided, isn't it? Oh, my gosh, everybody's mad. Everybody's fighting. Cities are divided. Political parties are divided. Men and women are divided. Every city has an across the tracks. We have racial divides, socioeconomic divides. There's always a group that considers themselves clean and a group that considers the rest of them unclean. There's always somebody there. There are Jaguar fans and there's the rest of the stupid world. Just threw that in there, and moving right along to the truth of the Word of God. But anyhow, somebody came up to me. I said, I see you're just throwing the rest of our teams under the bus. I said, look, I'll be humble about week six, but we've been so long since it's been even felt like this. I'm just going to be proud and arrogant for a few weeks, and then even if we're 7-0, I'm going humble. But I said, just for a few weeks, I just want to be arrogant. Back to this message. There are haves and have-nots. There are always three generational groups alive at any given time. Grandbabies, the ones who had the grandbabies, and the grandparents. And there's always three generations at least alive, and they're always all divided. The last generation is way smarter than the generation coming up. It's always been that way. Hello. I just love it when I hear people go, those millennials. I'm going, that's what they said about you when you're out smoking dopes in the woods with long hair and buckskin on. I said, you know what? I said, yeah, it's the same. Every generation looks back at the generation coming up behind them and tells them they're stupid and makes a divide. Everyone. Folks, here's what I'm trying to say. We have division in our churches. We have divisions over religion. We have divisions in our own camps over how we view the Bible. There's just a divided world, isn't it? Come on now, isn't it? Don't you just get sick of it? Is it any different than it was? Is it worse than it was 200 years ago? Is it worse than it was 500 years ago? Is it worse than it was 1,000 years ago? Don't say yes. It's not any worse. It's always been like this. They just have a megaphone now. We didn't used to have a megaphone. We didn't have internet. We didn't have Twitter. We didn't have whatever all of, we didn't have Facebook. We didn't have all these ways to post to everybody everything we know to be true, even if it's dead wrong. We didn't have this way to sound off around the world and be heard by everybody. But it's always been like this, folks. All these divides existed. They existed that day in Sychar at the well. So this little thing is important to us. Satan and sin love a divided world. They divide the world and then they turn the world on itself so that it cannibalizes itself and would never imagine somebody coming in and saying there's a better way to do life when they're fighting for all their life to prove their way is best. Satan's got a brilliant strategy and it's worked marvelously. But into the middle of that, you see it there in Samaria. Jews don't go through there. Jews don't talk to women. You wouldn't be seen as a rabbi talking to an immoral woman out here by this well. You would never be seen doing this. You know what? And you would never talk to Samaritan. And you sure wouldn't ask to be using my bucket and my cup. You wouldn't let my cup touch your lips. You'd never do it. And into all of our divided world marches our precious Jesus, marches right up to the well of Sychar and comes up and goes, I need a drink. I need a drink. Jesus doesn't fall into your camp, by the way. I just love it when some camp or some party or some group says, Jesus on our side. I'm going, he ain't never been on anybody's side. Folks, come on now. I mean, every camp's got something they pulled out of the Bible. Every group ever's got something they pulled out of the Bible, some verse they're going, see, we use the Bible. I'm going, oh, for crying out loud. Here's what I told Debbie this morning. You know what it's like? You remember when Joshua was out there and then he got up and he's out in the middle of the night kind of looking at Jericho going, how are we going to take this thing? And then he sees this person and he stands up, rips out his sword and he goes, are you for me or are you against me? Because Joshua was a fighter. And I love the answer, neither. And I wonder if Joshua would go, wrong answer. I meant for that. I didn't give you a third option here. Are you for me or against me? And he goes, neither. I'm God. And Joshua fell down on the ground. He goes, oh, I got it. Because Jesus didn't come down to prove you're right. Jesus didn't come to make our camps right, didn't come to make our party right. He didn't come down. He goes, no, look, all you all fighting with each other, but here's the deal, I'm God. I ain't gonna declare either one the winner, I'm declaring the kingdom of God. So everybody put down your swords and come join this. That is exactly what Jesus is saying at the well of Sychar to that woman that day. Galatians chapter 3, verse 26 through 28 says what he's trying to create of all these divided people. For in Christ Jesus, you are all sons of God through faith. For as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither slave nor free, there is no male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. That's what Jesus is here to do. He said, I'm going to collect all you, you're fighting with each other, come on, I'm going to make one out of you. That's why we want to have a diverse church. That's why we want to be made out of every social, I want to have a bunch of good Samaritan ladies at the well and a bunch of Nicodemuses from wherever they live. I want to have an everybody in between. I want them all colors, I want them all levels, I want them all academic degrees, I want them everybody. I want us all walking together building this church that Jesus said, I'm praying, Father, in John, later on, when he's praying before he leaves, part of his prayer, make my people one. Yes. Not divided. Not bringing their culture of viewpoints to bear on the church, but going, what's the Bible say we should be? Yes. So here, how's he do it? So here we go. Let me hurry along. Here's some things that you got to see. So how could we be better at working in this situation, if you were presented with whatever your situation is at the well of Sychar going, oh, we don't talk to these people. I don't know how to talk to these people. I don't know what you do with these kind of people. I mean, he's a Republican. How you talk to him? She's a Democrat. What do I say to her? They have the wrong bumper sticker on their car. He says, give me a drink. Give me a drink. You see what he's saying? Use your cup and your bucket. Get water out of it. Use your cup and pull out me a drink and I'll drink it. Now, I want to ask you something. Have any of you known somebody really famous that you thought, man, or just somebody you really admired and you just wanted them to ask you to do something for them? Because if they asked you to do something for them, it wasn't like a command using their position to control you. They were letting you know, I need you, and being needed is one of the greatest validating things ever. So if the God of the universe, it's not when Jesus goes, look, I can make that spring shoot up out of here, grab a cup full of water. I can make a cup on its way up, grab a cup of water, and take a drink. I'm God, for crying out loud. I walk on the water. I make leprosy fall off. I make blind eyes see. I turn rocks into, water into manna on a, laying on the grass in the middle of the, come on, you understand what I'm saying? This is God. So when he said, give me a drink, he was going, I need you. I can't get that water without you. Would you help me? What if it's that tone? I'm going to be thirsty unless you help me. And if you knew, if you just happened to know, and she didn't, but if you happened to know this is the Messiah, she's going to find out in a minute, this is God, she would have went, can I get you a drink, sir? Are you thirsty? Because she wouldn't have felt dehumanized. She wouldn't have felt dewomanized. She would have felt worthy. She would have felt so good. And Jesus just started there. Give me a drink. You want to reach people, folks, validate them. Validate them. Do you know I can't build this church without you? I can't reach this dream that God put in my heart to reach the city and all these lost folks and make disciples and build systems that people will be taken care of. We have stuff break down all the time around here and we get frustrated because we haven't built the right system or the right people. We're always working at it, praying, believing. I can't do it without you. I hope you never feel invalidated around here because there is no South Point without you. This is me up here doing this. I could do this to an empty room or to you. The church gets built by you. And I hope you never feel unimportant because you're amazingly important to Jesus, the kingdom of God, and to this church. So I'll ask you to give me a drink. I sure will. I'll ask you to serve here and I'll ask you to do this there. But I hope when I ask you and go, please work for us. Please do more to help us reach people. Please help us make disciples. Please lead a life group. Please go serve out in the rotunda. Please go serve in the children's department. Please go serve. I hope you always hear it is. We think we're doing the most important thing in the world. We think he's the most amazing thing in the world. He's the head of the church. Please go get him a drink. Please go get him a drink. And that you'll hear, he wants me. He needs me to help him. Oh, praise God forevermore. That's a whole different way of seeing it, isn't it? Validate people. Validate people. Make them significant. Especially the people that are marginalized. They need to be validated. They don't even think they belong. They don't think they belong on this earth. They don't think anybody wants them. Validate them. Number two, Jesus makes the gospel attractive. Next thing, after he validates and go, hey, look, I'll drink out of your cup. Be in that cup. She goes, you don't do this. No, I'll do it. Then he makes the gospel attractive because she's starting to go, I don't do this for you. You know we don't do this. He goes, well, look, if you knew who was talking to you, now he's kind of letting her in on it. If you knew who I was right now, you'd be asking me for water because I have this living water that if you drink them, this living water, you'll never be thirsty again. In fact, it will become a well that will spring up inside of you to eternal life. And she goes, whoa, she didn't get what he was saying. Who would? I mean, you wouldn't know what he was saying. She goes, well, where do you get this water? This is where do you get this water? And now think about what he's saying before we go into that. He is saying, I'm offering you something that so far supersedes anything you could ever imagine. You would be begging me for it. Folks, please make the gospel attractive. The gospel's got to be attractive. Jesus validates, and then he talks about this amazing life. He talks about John 10:10. He talks about being free from sin. He talks about being filled with the Spirit. He talks about having an amazing marriage. He talks about raising amazing kids. He talks about having amazing relationships. He talks about getting free from loneliness and free from addiction and free from burdens and free from weights. He talks about a life. He says, I'm offering you this life, and it will just well up inside you, and it just keeps coming and coming and coming and coming. It'll fill you up. You know you've had five husbands. You know you're living with the guy you're with. You know you keep trying to use a guy to figure out who you are. You know what? Right now, this can all change right now. If you'll just know who I am, I can give you the satisfaction inside of you that is causing you to do these kind of crazy things. I can do that for you right now. Man, we need to make the gospel attractive. But they can't meet us all the time, and we're just so beat down, so barely making it. That's why I preach victory. That's why I don't think we're made to lose. That's why I think we got to read our Bibles and figure it out. That's why I think we need to get transformed. That's why I think we need to be in our life groups and get help from one another and get through things in life, because we need to be looking around the world and going, you want this? This is what you want, what I got right here. We need to make the gospel attractive. Yes. Offer them, show them what it is. But then watch what happens. She goes, well, I want that water. I mean, I don't want to ever have to come back to this well again. So she kind of missed it. But Jesus wasn't done. He's cool with us. Don't you love the way Jesus is patient with us? You know, he knows we're stupid. So he just works with us. I just love this. And he goes, well, go get your husband. Now, this is a big deal here, right here. I want to be careful with this. And you know what? I do this wrong sometimes because I feel like I'm arguing with somebody else, but not with the person I'm talking to. So I'm not even going to start there. Just look at what Jesus does. He goes, go get your husband. And she goes, I don't have a husband. He goes, I know. You're living with the guy right now. You had five husbands before that. And she goes, okay, you read my mail. What's going on here? She goes, you're a prophet, aren't you? And so basically he is exposing something. So she's going, give me this water, this attractive gospel. He's going, well, there's an issue. There's an issue. Let's just start here. You're going, she lived with a guy that was cutting her up. No, she was ignoring the God of the word, because in her five books, she knew she wasn't supposed to be living with this guy. She knew how empty she was, and she knew she wasn't serving God. She knew she was away from God. She wasn't worshiping him. She wasn't making him Lord. She was living for herself. And Jesus just asks her a simple question that causes her to realize, I'm away from God because I have sin in my life. I have this problem. I'm not connected to him, and now what do I do? Are you hearing me, folks? You can't get to where Jesus wants you if you don't want Jesus to ever identify your sin. I know that's a struggle for people today, and I think in the first service I did it with maybe too much, because I get it, because there's people who don't believe this, and it frustrates me because I see people trapped when they're taught to ignore this part of the gospel, but it's right here. And so Jesus just walks her right into it. Walks her right into a moment of self-awareness. Okay, I'm awful. Really? You and I both know now how I'm living. I'm awful. And then, don't miss the point. Because a little bit later she goes, you know, we're looking for the Messiah. We'll talk about that next week. We're looking for the Messiah. And Jesus goes, I'm him. That's why I'm here. I'm here because of your problem. I'm going to tell you about your problem, and then I'm going to tell you who I am. That's what people miss, gang. I think we can stop there. I got these points to make, but just listen. He goes, I'm going to show you your problem. I'll walk you right into it. I feel so judged. He's going, don't feel judged. I'm here to fix it.
Right. So good.
I'm here to fix it. That's why I'm at this well. You know, when I told my guys we have to go through Samaria, it was to meet you, young lady. The Holy Spirit sent me to you, ma'am. I came to have this whole conversation with you. This is a setup. You came out when I got here. Some of you have been set up this morning. You're here, I'm here, but more importantly, Jesus is sitting at your well. And he goes, we can get through all this. I'm here to fix that. I'm here to fix that to the glory of God. That's why I came to Sychar. See, in John chapter 4, verses 25 and 26, he said, I know the Messiah is coming. She's saying this, and who? He's called the Christ. And when he comes, he will tell us all things. And she thought he was going to be a great teacher. And Jesus said to her, I who speak to you am he. And we know the woman goes away a believer. She believed and ran into town and told everybody about her. I'm not going to read the verses. And then some really neat things happen because she goes and goes, you got to see this guy who told me everything I ever did. And then all these Samaritans come out to meet this guy. So somehow she talked them into it. So they come out and meet Jesus and they go, hey, come stay at our house for 2 days. Hello? Stay in Samaria for 2 days. Wonder what that looked like, gang. Anybody thinking about it? What would it look like? When they got up for breakfast, or what did they do? Peter, what? Are you going to use their breakfast? What are we going to do? Ain't no dishes around here but their dishes. Are you going to tell anybody we did this when we get to where we're going? No one's going to want to be around us after we've been around them. Ooh, that must have been an interesting 2 days. Samaritans must have been sitting there going, what you going to do? You go, that wouldn't have happened. This is the Bible. She. Bible's full of people. Anybody realize that yet? Same ones we walk with today. When we're all going, that world is all messed up. That world's all messed up. Jesus walks right in the middle of our messed up world and goes, I'll stay 2 days. We're going to eat together. We're going to fellowship together. Folks, God is going to help me, and we're going to find a way to use homes at South Point Community Church to be transmitters of the gospel in the kingdom of God. We did neighboring, which I don't know if you go, I don't even know what neighboring is. It was a system we put out to help it happen, and I don't think it was the best way to go about it. So we're going to find another way to go, I want to use your home and use your home and use your home to be a kingdom outpost. And people sit down and go, you do this here? We're going to figure it out. Okay, I should close, huh? Let you go home and watch the game. Here's your takeaways. I'll just read through them. The first word in overcoming all cultural barriers is love. Love. Number two, don't bring your culture, your history, your bias, your background, or your context. I did this. Don't bring all your stuff, who you are, to God and Jesus and go, this is it. This is how it is. Work with it. Don't do that. That's not what Jesus was doing at the well. He took the Samaritan, took the woman, took the immoral lifestyle, and he looked at her and he goes, This is how my kingdom works. This is what I'm building. This is how it works. This is how it is. Work with it. Jesus doesn't take our culture and go, I'll work with that. He goes, no, you find mine, and I'll build an amazing you. Submit to God. Number three, submit to God and follow his rules. Sin is the great enemy to all the life that Jesus offers. Fourthly, surrender to Jesus. Get in the yoke with him. Give your life to him. If you're here this morning and you're going, golly, Russ, so he'll take me the way I am. Yep. Take you just the way you are. Move right through all the stuff of your life. But he won't leave you there. You have to view your life from this point on. You can't make Jesus Savior and receive his love and not his Lord and adopt his life. The two work hand in hand. Every head bowed and every eye closed. So if you're here this morning and you say, Russ Austin, I want to make Jesus Lord of my life. I want to make Jesus Lord of my life this morning. If that's you, I want you to raise your hand high in the air right now. I'm going to pray for you there in your chair, and God's going to change you forever. And you're going to become a child of God and be a part of this family. Anybody, raise your hand high in the air. Anyone? God bless you. Thank you, buddy. Anybody else? Others this morning? Yes. God bless you. Anyone else that I missed? I'm going to count to three, then I'm going to pray, and we're going to go home. I saw you. One, two, three. Raise your hand if you haven't raised it yet. We're going to pray for you to make Jesus Lord of your life. All right? Everybody in the room, pray this prayer with me. Father God, I know I have sin in my life. And I know you died for that sin. I know you love me and want all of your love to come to me. I surrender my life now to the work of Jesus on that cross. He died in my place that I might have his life. Fill me with your spirit. Forgive me. Teach me how to follow you. I surrender my life and commit it to you for the rest of my life. In Jesus' name, amen. If you prayed that prayer in a minute, you're born again forever. Somebody should talk with you before you leave the building this morning. Everybody stand. Folks, take a lesson from the well at Sychar, and let's build an amazing church of connected people. Let's get through all the stuff inside of us and fall in love with each other and be the one that Jesus called, and then show the world an attractive gospel that validates them. We're not mad at them. We don't hate them. We're out here to reach them. Amen? Let's go engage that world this week. Validate some people. Show them an attractive gospel. Bring them to church. Sit down with them. At some point, you're going to have to say, here's what separates you from my Jesus once you tell them about him. It's the stuff in your life. But he died for that. That's amazing. So even that's not a problem today. Get out there and do what God has called you to do, and let's just see what God can do with each one of us as we do so. Father God, bless this great people. Lift your hands. Bless this great people as they go out into the world and we say, live, work, and play. I pray that you would, God, fill them with your spirit, preserve them, protect them, fill them with joy, put the stuff in place that they need that's not there, take away the stuff that's in the way. And then we are going to be used of you, Lord God. We announce it as we leave this, but we're going to be used of you all week long and come back and celebrate great victories in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. God bless you all. We'll see you next Sunday. Bye-bye.